bows, bow our heads. Dearly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for moments like this, times of fellowship, to break bread, the very bread of life, Father, that sustains us. We're so grateful for your word as it washes over us, sets us free from the filth and the bondage of this world. What an incredible time to fellowship together this way, to enjoy our redemption, to be set free. We pray for those in the congregation that aren't here this morning for whatever reason, that you heal them, restore them, humble them, whatever is required, so that we might fellowship with them as well. We pray for those that are still lost in this world, Father. They are without hope, that they be humbled. Repent, receive saving faith before it's too late. We are most grateful and thankful, of course, for your Son's work on the cross to cancel out that debt and to make times like this just a time just to rejoice and love you, Father. We just ask for your blessings on this morning's message. May it be edifying for our souls. We ask this in Jesus Christ's precious name. By the power of the Spirit, we do pray. Amen. All right, part 146, the book of Hebrews. We're just going to jump right into our primary passage in Hebrews this morning. I think I mentioned this last time. We're going to accelerate a bit through our upcoming passages in this book because as a result of all our previous work in this book, we've already covered a good portion of the content that's coming up at the end of chapter 6 and then even the vast majority of chapter 7. That'll make more sense once we get into chapter 7. But before we do that, let's close out chapter 6 the way we always do and just read it through. Hebrews 6:13, go there. Hebrews 6:13. For when God made a promise to Abraham, since he had no one greater by whom to swear, he swore by himself, saying, surely I will bless you and multiply you. And thus Abraham, having patiently obtained the promise. For people swear by something greater than themselves, and in all their disputes, an oath is final for confirmation. So, when God desired to show more convincingly to the heirs of the promise the unchangeable character of his purpose, he guaranteed it with an oath, so that by two unchangeable things, in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. We're going to get to him here shortly. We might summarize, though, Hebrews 6:13 through 20 as emphasizing the certainty of God's promises, the certainty of God's promises. From last time, the key principle was our great hope for eternal salvation is God's integrity. So everything that we are hoping for depends wholly on whether or not God is a God after his own word, of his word. Is his integrity perfect? Is it immutable, so to speak? More specifically, if God promises to give something, what we've learned is, through Holy Scripture, he does. If God promises to give something, he does. And if you think about this more broadly, I was thinking about this morning, that's the very basis of godly grace. I'll say it again. If God promises to give something, he does. And that's the very basis of godly grace. Unlike human beings, God cannot lie. It's against his very nature. So a promise is a promise to God. He makes a promise, it's as good as gold. His very integrity to what he teaches us to be grace depends upon it. His integrity to grace depends on it. If we ever wish to truly be gracious, then, ourselves, we must be like God. Go to James 5:12. James 5:12. If we ever wish to truly be gracious, we must be like God. So what does that mean? James had something to say about this. James 5:12. And I could, you know, Chris, Deacon Fredericks, we're talking about this morning regarding membership of this church even, right? If you're a member of this church, part of even in the bylaws, it says you will make every attempt possible to be here, to support the church, to support others. Just being here is a promise that you made as a member of this church, right? Well, what does James have to say about such promises? James 5:12, but above all, my brothers, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath. So the context here is that James's contemporaries would swear every which way, not by the Lord. Like they would swear by, and we'll get to this for a second. But above all, my brothers, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath. But let your yes be yes, and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. Let your yes be yes, and your no be no. That's what we call integrity. Right? You may not even agree with a person who says yes to one thing or no to another, but you can at least have a certain level of respect for a person who sticks by their word. Right? What's worse than a waffler? That's what we see in politics all the time, right? They're like the wind half the time. Let your yes be yes, and let your no be no. And if you can't do that, then shut up. You're better off saying nothing than just filling the air with noise. If your word is crap, excuse my French, if your word is crap, then just don't say anything. If you can't be trusted, and you know that about yourself, then you're better off saying nothing. But if you do say yes, then it should be yes. And if you do say no, then it should be no. Is that fair? That's what James is getting at. Okay? Now, I was thinking about this, because the context here, again, is that James, in James's time, people were swearing by everything. And I was saying, all right, what about nowadays? Ever heard someone say, I swear on my mother's grave? Ever hear anybody say that? First of all, that's just grotesque. But second of all, I must say that I've heard it many times in my life. I swear on so-and-so's grave. What? Or even other variants like, I swear on my kid's life. Or, I swear on my heart, and they cross their heart and hope to die. You ever heard of any of these things? Swearing by everything? You get the point. People have a bad habit of swearing by their idols and such instead of in the presence of God. What James is saying, don't do that. Don't do that. You shouldn't have to cross your heart and hope to die. Your word should be good enough. You're better off being credible enough to be trusted. That's the goal here. Being credible enough to be trusted. People don't need to agree with everything you say. So you don't say no just because the yes is going to offend somebody. You say no because that's what you feel, that's what you think, that's your conclusion. I say no in the circumstance because that's what I discern is the right thing to do. My good conscience, the conscience that God gave me, says no in this circumstance. Oh, but I might offend somebody, so I'm going to say yes. No. No. That is not what the Bible says. You're better off being credible enough to be trusted. You should have enough integrity that when you say yes, you mean yes. And when you say no, you mean no. Parents out there, I hope you heard that, because your kids are watching you and discerning your integrity. Kids aren't stupid. They're sponges. They're watching you. Every move you make, and they may not agree with you. They may hate, oh, I hate you. You don't understand. The teenage girl. Sorry, Willow. You don't understand what I'm going through. I hate you. My answer is still no. Now what if, I'm sorry, sweetie. I'll change it to yes. Beware. Your kids are watching you and discerning your integrity. As in, is my mom or dad a person of integrity? Is my mom or dad a person of their word? If the answer is yes, then chances are your kids will sleep better at night. If it's no, then you might have a clue as to why your kids are insecure in general. I would say this is a big part of why there's so much anxiety in children nowadays. It starts with the home. The parents don't have a clue. Nobody's with Christ anymore. So there's no grounding. There's no true north. There's no beating to the same drum. They're thumbing through their morality. Oh, this is another good argument I heard from so-and-so on the internet. I'm going to change my morality. I'm going to change my mind about this thing day to day. And the kids are going, hey, mom and dad, what the heck is going on? I'm feeling a little insecure here. You guys don't have your act together. So, if you don't have any integrity, you might have a clue as to why your kids are insecure in general. The question is, did you give them the security God wanted you to instill in them from an early age? Or were you a, quote, waffler that bent at their every whim as you tried to be their friend, let's say? Friend. I mean, God forbid you offend your own kids nowadays, right? But I digress. You get the point. Again, look at James 5:12. But above all, brothers, my brothers, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. In other words, be a man or a woman of integrity. Who's our model? God is. God's yes is always yes. And his no is always no. And that relates back to the point the writer of Hebrews was making. This is our God. We know for a fact, without any variation or shifting shadow, that God is immutable. He doesn't change his mind because we're throwing a tantrum and we're crossing our arms and I've been praying for this thing for so long and I'm just coming back empty. You got your answer. You know what the answer is? No. That's your answer. But I don't like that one. And when I was growing up, if I pounded on the floor and crossed my arms and off, my mom and dad, they changed their mind. That's because they're bad parents. Parents without integrity are terrible parents because they make their kids terribly insecure. And now the kids are all anxious and everything else growing up. And then they become adults, and then the cycle keeps going. It's hard for human parents to be good parents nowadays. I would argue it's harder than ever because of media, because of even what's being taught in schools nowadays. But here's the deal. Parents, you ready? You are responsible for your children. Don't blame schools. Don't blame public teaching systems. Don't blame anything else. If your kid's all screwed up, look in the mirror. That's the first place you should be looking. And do you have integrity? Because it's hard. A lot of times it's easier just to give in. But they're throwing a tantrum. Yeah, I know. Live it. Own it. God's yes is always yes, and his no is always no. That's the point the writer of Hebrews was making. And that's our confidence. And consider the parent analogy I just gave you. Our Father in heaven is perfect. Perfect integrity. Does that not give you a sense of security? It does for me. I may not always like what he has to say, but I can trust him. You may not always like when God says no to you, but at least you can embrace the sense of security you have in knowing that God never waffles. So just put the two together. The fact that God never waffles, and you know for a fact that you're more secure in knowing that, whether you like or not what he has to say to you, put that in your own life then. Just for a little encouragement, go to Numbers 23:19. Numbers 23:19. Numbers 23:19. God is not man that he should lie, or a son of man that he should change his mind. Has he said, and will he not do it? Or has he spoken, and will he not fulfill it? Go to Psalm 33:11. Psalm 33:11. Just a little friendly reminder from God the Holy Spirit this morning as to God's integrity, God's word, the veracity of his word. Psalm 33:11. The counsel of the Lord stands forever. The plans of his heart to all generations. The counsel of the Lord stands forever. I've had people tell me publicly, attack me publicly, and say, hey, get with it, dude. It's 2024. Get with the times. I think I won't. Because God doesn't get with the times. This is it, folks. God's not changing his mind. It's not a new Bible. We don't get to retranslate or reinterpret to fit this ridiculousness of this world into Holy Scripture. We interpret the world through Holy Scripture. We don't interpret Holy Scripture through the world. Those are two different lenses. We use this lens to interpret the nastiness out there. We don't use that nasty lens to interpret this. The Lord's counsel stands forever. Go to Malachi 3:6. Malachi 3:6, right before the New Testament. Malachi 3:6. Malachi 3:6. For I, the Lord, do not change. Any questions? For I, the Lord, do not change. Doesn't matter if it's 30-24 or 40-24. It's going to be the same. His word stands for all generations. God doesn't change his mind. Then go to James 1:17. I alluded to this earlier. James 1:17. You should be encouraged by this. I don't know what I'd think if God arbitrarily changed his mind. I mean, I don't know what I'd even think about what. Does that mean Holy Scripture is no longer appropriate? Because it's 2024? I mean, I don't know what. It'd be awful. I love that God never changes. It gives me something to stand on. It gives me solid ground to stand on. He's a perfect father. James 1:17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Not a whole lot of gray area, you see? No variation or shadow. Don't try to, like, you know, marginalize what God says, because it's a little easier for me if I kind of, like, you know, act like a lawyer, you know, try to find the quote-unquote gray areas. If you're looking for gray areas in this, you're already missing the mark. Because that means you're being like Satan. You're looking for ways out. You're looking for little loopholes. You're looking for disclaimers. You're looking for whatever it is your ridiculous mind is trying to prove so you can get away with something ungodly. That's typically the route. Is that fair? Right? Everybody looking. I get the craziest questions. At this point in my career, it's not, nothing's new. Right? It usually has something to do with relationships, often divorce, remarriage, sex, family, you know, whatever. Hot topics. And you can tell by the way that they're asked to me that they're looking for a loophole. They're looking for a gray area. They're looking for something in Holy Scripture that'll let them slide. Is that, be honest, is that approaching Holy Scripture with integrity? Or is that approaching the Word of God with an agenda? Is that trying to interpret Holy Scripture through the lens of your flesh? Or is that you trying to use the lens of Holy Scripture to interpret your flesh? You know the answer to that. It's awesome that God doesn't change. It's awesome that we don't have to try to lawyer our way into the truth. That he's actually given it to us in Holy Scripture. That we can be secure in his promises, whatever they may be. We may not even like them. Talked about all those things that people come at me with. Very often, they don't like what I have to say. We just had an entire family leave this congregation because the father didn't like what I had to say. That simple. Literally that simple. But I wasn't going to bend. I told the truth. Now they're gone. You want me to lie to you? You want me to be a bad parent? Right? right? Sooner or later, you're going to look at me and say, I don't know if I trust that guy. Even though he waffled and made my life a little easier in the short term, now I don't trust him. Which pastor do you want? Do you want the one who gives you the truth, regardless of whether or not it hurts? Or do you want somebody who waffles because it makes you feel good for a time? Which one do you want? Which one are you going to trust long term? You can answer that for yourself. I'm trying to be godly. God doesn't have to try. Anyways, if you're looking for shadows and, you know, disclaimers and loopholes, you're on the wrong tack altogether. Anyways, those Bible verses we just read, we should be encouraged, emboldened by them. Again, the carryover principle from last week is our great hope for eternal salvation is God's integrity. You don't want a God that changes his mind. Amen? You just don't. You want to be insecure your whole life? You're going to go, oh, I don't know, man. I don't know. Am I going into heaven or not? Am I good enough? Is God going to change his mind about my salvation? Is he going to kick me out of heaven and my hope? What if he changes his mind? He says, that used to be the way to salvation, but I've changed my mind. How secure are you going to be? How's that for an anchor? That sounds like one of those anchors that never touch bottom. Or you got a giant, I've done this before. You ever been in a boat, a sizable boat, and the anchor's this big? Right? And he's just like, what's happening? He's just like on the ground, on the, you know, the seafloor, just dragging around. It's like, yeah, it's a little bit, but it's just, how's that for an anchor to the soul? Yeah. Our great hope, the anchor of our hope for eternal salvation is God's integrity. When he says yes, he means yes. When he says no, he means no. And when he promises something, it's a promise. By grace, we have been saved. You can hang your hat on that. God cannot even change his mind, even if he wanted to. Do you understand? He can't. He's incapable of changing his mind. Even if he had this weird out-of-body experience and said, I want to change my mind. His own integrity would disallow it. Go to Ephesians 2:1. Ephesians 2:1. So if that's our God, when we read Ephesians 2:1, I am elated. I am stoked. Diane, I'm stoked. Oh, jeez. Did you see Diane? That's our God. Think about it. So when you think about a God who will never change his mind, and then he's given us his word, like Ephesians 2. What does it mean to you? How much more firm is your faith? Is your trust in him? In his promises? Well, here we go. Ephesians 2:1. Let's read this with that in mind. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. That's how we were all born. Spiritually dead, totally depraved, without any hope. Verse 3. Among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Paul said it best regarding where his salvation came from. Go to 1 Corinthians 15:10. What do you say to all that? If that's what God has to say about our salvation, what do you have to say about it? Paul said it very succinctly, 1 Corinthians 15:10. But by my own works, I am what I am. Is that what it says? By the awesomeness that is me? Huh? I am awesome. I mean, all right, all right, all right. God did 98%, but I was right there and ready for that 2%. I know. The Bible says I was dead as a doornail, laying on the ground. I can't see anything, can't hear anything. Basically useless. But somehow, I am so much better than my neighbor that I got up with a 2% effort and closed the deal. Right? Nope. Paul said it very succinctly. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. That sounds like a man who said, this is all God. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be doing this. If it wasn't for him, I would not be saved. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have an anchor in my soul, a hope of salvation. I wouldn't have any of it. If it was dependent on me, I would screw it up. Certainly, I would screw it up. Raise your hand if your yes has always been yes and your no has always been no. You can't even be trusted with Halloween candy. Did you eat that Snickers? And this is like you to your kids, right? Your kids are like, Mommy, my basket seems a little low. Oh, must have been your father. You can't even do it like that with silly stuff. God's grace. His grace alone. We can't be trusted for anything. We can't be trusted to save ourselves. You know what a bad bet that is? This is like the worst possible bet you could possibly ever dream up. To tell somebody. And there are whole religions that tell people on a Sunday morning like this, if you do enough good works, you'll get into heaven. Then you all have to ask them is, I'm just curious. I'm just throwing it out there. How much is enough? Do you feel secure in that? Because that makes me, just thinking about it, really, really insecure. Because then I don't know how much is good enough. And then you get everybody doing the shuffle at the end of their life, right? I don't know, man. I look back at my life and I just lived like hell for 70 years, but I think I've still got enough life. I'm going to do a bunch of good stuff to try to offset the balance so I can make sure I get into heaven. Are you watching, Lord? Look at all this good stuff. I helped the old lady across the street. I paid for someone's groceries. I go to church. you know, I cook some clam chowder for the church. I do all these, and I'm a pretty awesome guy. And everybody's like, yeah, you're an awesome guy. God's like, what are you doing? I sent my son. He said, I am the way and the truth and life. No one comes to the Father but through me. You need my righteousness, kiddo, not your own ridiculous attempt at being righteous. By the grace of God, I am what I am. Where does grace come from? One place, God alone. Lest you might what? Boast. I've taught this principle many times in the past, but it never gets old. From last week, grace is no longer grace if we must work for it. And I'll add one more clarifying principle for emphasis. If we ever had to, quote, work for God's grace, we'd always fail ourselves because our human capabilities are flawed. God's standard of righteousness is nothing short of perfection. The Bible says if you failed in one part of the law, you failed the whole law. Raise your hand if you've never lied. Okay, you failed the whole law. Only Christ's imputed righteousness by God's grace can meet God's standard for salvation. So you see, the simple fact that God's grace is the key to salvation, this is very good news. And the gospel literally translated means good news, right? That's what the gospel means. Well, what's so good about it? That God does all the work. That's what's good about it. Because if it was dependent on us, it would be really bad news. And that's why there are so many insecure religious people out there. Because they think it depends on them. And everybody here knows well enough, we kind of suck. We're kind of not so good. We kind of don't say yes when we mean yes. We don't say no when we mean no. We're kind of not good at this perfect thing. And if the standard is perfect righteousness, and we can't even tell our kids the truth about Halloween candy, we got problems. Unless it's all by God's grace. Thanks be to God. Amen? That's good news. We read Romans 4, 1 to 8 last time, where the Apostle Paul drives this point home. I'll just read you 4 to 5 here. Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but what is as his due. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Again, grace is no longer grace if we must work for it. The conclusion from last time, we have confidence in our salvation because we have confidence in God's ability to save us and keep us saved by grace. That's the point we've been studying out. All right, as promised, we need to press on into Hebrews 7 now. So let's do ourselves a big favor. This is a habit that we all should get into. I certainly do it. You should do it as well, right? Even if you've been studying a certain passage within a book, read the whole chapter. When you're done with that passage and you feel like you've nailed it, go back and read the whole chapter. Better yet, go read the book if you happen to have the time, right? For what? Context. To take what you've now learned and put it in the right place, in context, in plenary scripture, as we would say. So let's read the entirety of chapter 6 to put a bow on it. We're just about finished. And let's bring into remembrance all the Spirit pointed out over the past few months of studying this beautiful chapter. Remember, we spent a lot of time on verses 4 through 6 because those were sort of points of contention, even in Christianity, but let's just read right through it, see how it all fits. Hebrews 6:1. Therefore, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, and of instruction about washings, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. All in this we will do if God permits. Verse 4, for it is impossible in the case of those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, and have shared in the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the powers of the age to come, and then have fallen away, to restore them again to repentance, since they are crucifying once again the Son of God to their own harm and holding him up to contempt. For land that has drunk the rain that often falls on it and produces a crop useful to those for whose sake it is cultivated receives a blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and thistles, it is worthless and near to being cursed, and its end is to be burned. Though we speak in this way, yet in your case, beloved, we feel sure of better things, things that belong to salvation. For God is not unjust so as to overlook your work and the love that you have shown for his name in serving the saints, as you still do. And we desire each one of you to show the same earnestness, to have the full assurance of hope until the end, so that you may not be sluggish, but imitators of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. For when God made a promise to Abraham, since he had no one greater by whom to swear, he swore by himself, saying, surely I will bless you and multiply you. And thus Abraham, having patiently waited, obtained the promise. For people swear by something greater than themselves, and in all their disputes an oath is final for confirmation. So when God desired to show more convincingly to the heirs of the promise the unchangeable character of his purpose, he guaranteed it with an oath, so that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And that finishes chapter 6. So here, though, we have again this ancient priest, Melchizedek, this ancient priest that we first encountered in our study a few months back. Instead of going through all the proof points and the investigation of this mysterious Melchizedek character in the Bible, let me just pull from the annals of our previous parts of this series. Okay, we did a lot of work, if you remember, when we first met Melchizedek in chapter 5. We did a lot of flipping in our Bibles to figure out, it was scarce what was said about this individual, but we did all our due diligence on him back in chapter 5. So we did a lot of good labor not that long ago when reference to this ancient priest came up. Now, if you're interested, as a point of reference, those were parts 104 to 116. So parts 104 through 116. But I want to quickly review that since we've come across it in chapters 6 and 7 now. Go back to Hebrews 5:1. Hebrews 5:1. This should be very familiar. We studied this not so long ago. 5 comes before 6. Hebrews 5:1. For every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes this honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obeyed him. And then verse 10, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. And that was our launching pad, remember? Chapter 5 was when we first met this individual Melchizedek, and we went back and forth and back to the Old Testament reference, sort of the first mention, if you would. It's just Psalm 110:4. I'll read it here. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. So this individual was certainly introduced to us in the Old Testament. The New Testament writer, the writer of Hebrews, is just referring back to this person. And this would have been a person, since this particular house church was most likely familiar with Old Testament, they would have known who this person was, but the writer still took them back to Old Testament references. So, at the mention of Melchizedek, we took pause to investigate. It turns out there's not a whole lot said about this man, other than his ministry was unique and a type of Christ's. We looked at Genesis 14, where Melchizedek was first mentioned as king of Salem. We also noted that he was a priest who served Abram. And we concluded that his position was superior to Abram. Remember, Abram even gave him tithes. It turns out that the most common reference to this man are actually in the book we're in, the book of Hebrews. We also noted that if we break down his name, we get the Hebrew Melech, which means king, and Tzedek, which means righteous, in other words, a righteous king. Melchizedek was a righteous king during Abraham's time. Okay? But he had a very unique ministry. And our quick takeaway from our studies back in, 104 to 116, back then, this is what we got out of all that good labor back then. Melchizedek is given preeminence over Abraham and ultimately Aaron, the first Levitical high priest. He was appointed, remember that word appointed in Hebrews, he was appointed by God, not based on his genealogy, as Aaron would be, right? Levitical priesthood was all genealogy based, right? But he was not. He was appointed by God, not based on his genealogy. His life is referred to without a beginning or an end, typifying an eternal priestly ministry like Christ's. No beginning, no end, an eternal priestly ministry like Christ. If you recall, we spent a good portion of our investigation of Melchizedek in our next chapter, chapter 7. We get a lot of sort of meat out of chapter 7. Even though we're in chapter 5 at the time, we went forward to chapter 7 to figure out who is this guy. Hence my previous comment about going quickly through this chapter now, because we've already done a lot of work on chapter 7. With that said, let's pick up where we left off again. Look at Hebrews 6:19. We're just going to grab our momentum again. Hebrews 6:19. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Remember, there are no chapter breaks in the original manuscripts. So even though we see Hebrews 6:20 and then 7:1, those didn't exist in original manuscripts, right? And just a little history lesson here in case you're interested. The chapter divisions commonly used today were developed by Stephen Langton, an Archbishop of Canterbury in 1227. So think about that. Before 1227, there were no chapter and verse. It was just the good book. The Wycliffe English Bible of 1382 was the first Bible to use this chapter pattern. Still just chapters, by the way. Since the Wycliffe Bible, nearly all Bible translations have followed Langton's chapter divisions. And a little later, scholars further divided into verses. The Old Testament was divided into verses by a Jewish rabbi by the name of Nathan in 1448. Robert Estienne, who was also known as Stephanus, was the first to divide the New Testament into numbered verses in 1555. He also adopted Nathan's verse divisions for the Old Testament. So you can see all sort of coming together, chapter and verse coming together around 1555. Since that time, beginning with the Geneva Bible, the chapter and verse divisions employed by Stephanus have been accepted into nearly all Bible versions. Isn't that funny? Not that long ago. 1555 in the grand scale of things is not that long ago. That's only about a quarter of the way back as far as the Bible is concerned, right? Should say where Jesus came at least. No, again, the point is that there were no chapters or verses in the original manuscripts. So just remember that when we go from chapter 6 to chapter 7. When we transition from 6 to 7, for example, that's a point of reference that God, the Holy Spirit, didn't necessarily inspire. So it's okay to simply maintain our train of thought from what we know as the end of chapter 6 and carry it immediately into chapter 7. At the tail end of, as we call it, chapter 6, verse 20, we have this person again, once again introduced in the study, Melchizedek. Okay? So look at verse 20, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. So, the writer of Hebrews introduces the priestly order of Melchizedek. He sort of expounds upon the priestly order of Melchizedek, as we noted again months ago now when we studied chapter 5. So let's read chapter 7 together, because I'm just about out of time. And we'll just continue next week. 7:1, just continuing that thought. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, met Abraham, returning from the slaughter of the kings, and blessed him. And to him Abraham apportioned a tenth part of everything. He is first, by translation of his name, king of righteousness, and then he is also king of Salem, that is, king of peace. He is without father or mother or genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but resembling the Son of God, he continues a priest forever. See how great this man was, to whom Abraham, the patriarch, gave a tenth of the spoils. And those descendants of Levi who received the priestly office have a commandment in the law to take tithes from the people, that is, from their brothers, though these also are descended from Abraham. But this man, who does not have his descent from them, received tithes from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. It is beyond dispute that the inferior is blessed by the superior. In the one case, tithes are received by mortal men, but in the other case, by one of whom it is testified that he lives. One might even say that Levi himself, who receives tithes, paid tithes through Abraham. For he was still in the loins of his ancestor when Melchizedek met him. Now here's where the writer of Hebrews begins comparing Jesus to this ancient priest, Melchizedek. Verse 11. Now, if perfection had been attainable through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need would there have been for another priest to arise after the order of Melchizedek, rather than one named after the order of Aaron? For when there is a change in the priesthood, there is necessarily a change in the law as well. For the one of whom these things are spoken belonged to another tribe, from which no one has ever served at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord was descended from Judah, and in connection with that tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. This becomes even more evident when another priest arises in the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become a priest not on the basis of a legal requirement concerning bodily descent, but by the power of an indestructible life. For it is witnessed of him, you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. For on the one hand, a former commandment is set aside because of its weakness and uselessness, for the law made nothing perfect. But on the other hand, a better hope is introduced through which we draw near to God. And it was not without an oath, for those who formerly became priests were made such without an oath. But this one was made a priest with an oath by the one who said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. This makes Jesus the guarantor of a better covenant. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But he holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He has no need, like those high priests, to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men in their weakness as high priests, but the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. Amen. We're out of time, but as you can see, we've covered a lot of this ground already when we first met up with Melchizedek in chapter 5. So we're going to go relatively quickly through chapter 7, it seems. I'll probably eat my words because you know how it goes. I said that, and now he's going to be like, no. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for today, for giving us truth that sets us free. We just ask for blessings as we take said truth back to the privacy of our own souls, to our families even, and your will be done to a world that needs the truth so desperately. We ask this in Jesus Christ's precious name. By the power of the Spirit, we do pray. Amen. Thank you.